Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The text for this morning's sermon is the gospel lesson, and I will read once again for our hearing from the ESV, English Standard Version. Beginning at verse 49. I came to cast fire on the earth, and would that it were already kindled. I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Do you think that I have come to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. For from now on, one house there will be five divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. This is the word of the Lord. And today we hear that Jesus endured a baptism of suffering, and because of that, we will endure a baptism of suffering and division. You may be seated. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, what do you and I have in common with each and every person here this morning and each and every person on this earth? No, it's not size or shape or gender or culture or language, even ethnicity, philosophy, or even our financial status. Aside from being flesh and blood, you and I have something in common with each and every person. Death. You and I and every person who is born of woman will die. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, as Paul writes. And therefore, because we have sinned, we do fall short of His glory. And because of that, we will die physically. Thus, in birth, we are born into sin, into rebellion, open rebellion against our Creator. It's been this way ever since Adam and Eve took a bite of the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Adam and Eve were destined to die. Because we are descendants of Adam, you and I are destined to die. Then along came Jesus. And His words today begin by saying, I came to cast fire on the earth, and would that it were already kindled. I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Peter writes it this way, Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. This fiery trial that Jesus is speaking of, bringing fire to the earth, and the fiery trial that Peter is speaking of, you and I know all so well. We call it suffering. Each and every one of us know, maybe the children don't necessarily realize it yet, but each and every one of us suffer in some way. We'll touch on that in a moment. It's interesting that Jesus says He is bringing fire upon the earth. The Greek word for fire is pure. Pure, as in purify, as in purification. It's something we don't really realize, but to purify, for instance, gold, it has to be put into the fire. And the more the gold is put into the fire, more the dross rises to the top and poured off. And the more pure and pure the gold comes each time it is fired. The Christian, each time the Christian is inserted or put into the fire, the old evil, the dross is poured off, and you and I become more and more pure. Isaiah writes it this way, that we, as His children, will have to endure the furnace of affliction. We all know what a furnace is. When we hear a furnace in the Old Testament, we immediately think of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The fire was so hot that the men who threw them in were killed. But yet they lived, and there was a fourth man in there with them. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego underwent a purification, if you will. They came out of the fire, and their clothes didn't even smell of smoke. And that fourth man in there with them, we know, was an angel, there to protect them. Well, you and I, if we were thrown into a fiery furnace, oh, we would die physically, but spiritually, we would not even smell of smoke. We would smell of the honey of heaven, because it is the gospel of God that has saved us, Jesus Christ himself. Jesus says he wished that it were already kindled, this fire. He wished that suffering would already start. That sounds odd, doesn't it? Jesus was bringing division into the world, but it was necessary. Jesus had to bring this fire. There has to be division because it is necessary for salvation. Not everyone will be saved. We have to be honest with ourselves. We know that not everyone will be saved because some will resist this purification process. They resist baptism. They resist the Lord's Supper. They resist even coming to this building to hear the truth that they are sinners and that unless they repent, they will die not only physically, they will die spiritually. Then they will smell of smoke forever. You see, Jesus had to tell us this. He had to prepare us for this, for he knows that your salvation and my salvation is just too precious to let anyone or anything stop the work that he was to accomplish. And we know what his work was. When he left the Mount of Transfiguration, Scripture tells us that he set his face as a flint toward Jerusalem. A flint creates a spark. A spark creates fire. And at the cross, the world was divided. Either you believe or you don't believe. And as the children just saw and as you just saw, you cannot straddle the fence. It will not work. Either you're on the right, either you're for Jesus, or you're on the left, you're against Jesus. There's no middle ground. There's no moderation. There are no moderates. Either you are or you aren't. But before this happens, Jesus tells us, I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Now, when Jesus said this, he had already been baptized in the Jordan. He wasn't talking about the baptism in the Jordan. Rather, he was talking of a baptism in a figurative sense, a baptism of fire. Jesus was going to walk the way that we have to walk as Christians. Jesus himself would suffer. And that's why we too as Christians suffer. Our Lord suffered, we suffer. The way to glory, my dear friends, is through suffering. Are you willing to suffer as did your Savior? Oh, it's true, you and I will never be nailed to a cross anyway. I hope we are never nailed to a cross. I never hope that you and I are ever scourged as Jesus was. If you saw the Passion of the Christ, that is just a very, very scratch on the surface of what really truly happened to Jesus in scourging. It is horrendous. I fail to even find words to describe it. And then being laid on a cross, a rough hewn cross. It wasn't a nice smooth cross. Splinters thrown on it, nailed to it, lifted up. I hope that never happens to us. But rather our suffering is these things. Broken relationships. Hatred of others, even in our own family. Sorrow. Persecution. I know each and every one of you have endured these things, especially the broken relationships. Satan tries to divide us, and he divides us from our Lord by using other people. The non-Christian in your family, as you saw with the children, they will stand on the other side of the tape, if you will, on the other side of Jesus, and ridicule you. In a sense, they are persecuting you, telling you that you are crazy to believe this stuff about a man who was nailed to a cross, rose on the third day, ascended into heaven, and coming again. That's lunacy. Yet Jesus said, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and the scribes and be killed. Even in the garden, Jesus prayed, Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose, I have come to this hour. Jesus knew that through his suffering, through his fiery trial, that at the end, as he hung on the cross, he would have to suffer the horrors of his Father's wrath, frightening as it is. But Jesus was bound and determined to do this. There was nothing on this earth or below the earth that was going to stop him. And he went to the cross, not for himself. He endured this baptism of fire, not for himself. He endured it so that you and I wouldn't have to be scourged or nailed to a cross. Because of this, the Lord tells us that at the cross brings division. Do you think that I have come to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. And then Jesus describes the division even in families. Why does he use five? Now, many of your families are larger than five, but five was a traditional size of an Oriental family. The father, the mother, the son, the eldest son especially, his wife, and then the youngest child. That was the basis, that was the core of an Oriental family in Jesus' day. And he's telling us, of those five people, two or even three will bring division. They will tell the other two or the other three that their faith is futile. They're wasting their time. Don't go to church. Stay in bed. Or stay in home and watch cartoons or watch sports. Do something other than going to church. What? Being baptized does nothing. What? Coming to the altar and receiving his body and blood? What a waste of time. You know it's the truth because it happens in your families. You know it's the truth. And as you hear these words, I know in your mind you're thinking of someone, a family member, who is just like this. They bring division in your family. You see, the words of Jesus are true. The words for you today, though, my friends, are these. And the words of Jesus for you are these. He tells us many times, fear not, O little flock. Do not lose hope. Let not temptation turn you from me. Keep your focus on the cross. Remain standing on the right side. Stand with Jesus. And in the end, you will be justified. And those who tried to bring division in your life, they will be condemned. Yes, my dear friends, we certainly suffer in this life. I hesitate to tell you that maybe pastors suffer more than you, but we really don't because we're all in this together. I suffer maybe different kinds of persecutions, but you suffer persecutions too, just because you are called a Christian, a follower of Christ, the Anointed, the Holy One. These words are so important, and I ask you to remember these words. Even write them on your heart. Memorize them. Paul wrote to the Romans and said, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us. And that glory will be revealed on the great last day. We will shine like the sun. But that family member, that person who tried to divide, they will never shine. Rather, they will endure hell forever. That doesn't mean we stop proclaiming the gospel to them. That doesn't mean we stop associating with them in any way. Rather, we speak the truth in love. For it is the Holy Spirit who will break their hardened heart. And we pray that one day they will fall to their knees, confess their sins, and be saved. Therefore, all these words that you heard this morning from the Holy Scripture, you know they're true because they're from the Lord, and His words are true. I pray that these words make you more resolute. They make you more strong to walk the same path as your Lord. Continue walking your baptism of fire. For at the end of your baptism of fire, Jesus tells you very clearly, he who endures to the end, I will give a crown of life. My dear friends, he himself, your Lord, has washed you in the waters of holy baptism. He has also washed you with his holy and precious blood. So therefore, these words are so important to us as we endure these fiery trials. My friends, hear and believe that all your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise. And now the peace of God, through our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you forever in the truth that Jesus is your Savior. Amen. You may be seated for the offering.